recordar.
Well, first of all, I'd like to thank all the organizations that put this together. That's a huge coordination effort. The Sea Grant Institute, the Gulf of Mexico, Great Lakes Commissions, and the IJC. Anyway, thank you so much for hosting this event. And also thank you to the audience, and thank you for everyone who's listening in. It's very, very great. What I'm going to talk about today is just very simply how crude oil moves into the Great Lakes Basin, how it gets here now, how it's moving, things like that. So, there's not a lot of time because it's a very involved circumstance, so I'm going to try to go quickly and simply. Here's the outline. Very simply, I'm going to talk about the refineries, first of all, because they're the customers. You will start to lose out on the customers. I'm going to talk about them. I'm going to talk about the pipeline network. Got a few slides on that. A few on the rail network. A few on the waterways. And I've got here some projects that are outside of the region here, which are going to have a big impact on it. So I'd like to talk about those. So here we go. First of all, there are the customers. They're all pictured there. Those are the refineries, the main refineries in the Great Lakes region. We have a lot. We have 4 million barrels of processing capacity, 4 million barrels a day. That's a lot of capacity. It's 20% of the U.S. refineries are up here in our own home region here. So, the thing is that these refineries, interestingly enough, you know, the big ones, they're small ones. This is sort of headquartered in Chicago with a big one in Minneapolis and a big one in, looks like, the St. Louis area, Illinois. But these refineries all get oil from pretty much anywhere in the world. So how does that happen? Well, it happens because there's a very elaborate network of pipelines that connects them all. So on to the tangled web of pipelines that we have here. And I'm going to skip through some slides here, but there's the map. So if you can visualize the last picture of red dots of refineries, this is the overlay. It's the web of pipelines that makes all the deliveries. And so it's like a little shuttle service running back and forth and everywhere. Now, some of those pipelines have large diameters, big capacity. Those are all mentioned in my report. They're all described in the report. But essentially, for refineries in the United States, this is a very important point. I'd like you all to know that at least 90% of all the oil you get comes by pipeline. There is some rail, there is some, you know, barge, things like that on the Mississippi River. But for the U.S. and Canadian produced oil, I think it's something like 95% actually moved by pipeline. So it's far and away the dominant form of transportation. So I'm not going to go through the details of this, but I want to give you two ideas coming out of this picture. And here's one of them. That crosshatched area there, the shaded area, that's generally the pipelines. But there's one route that brings in, up there, there's a pipeline network that comes down into Chicago, and it brings Canadian crude, and it also brings a lot of Bakken crude down too. Because the Bakken area, though everyone thinks of it with regard to rail, actually a lot of it moves by pipeline. So, and those pipelines tend to run full. And as more Canadian crude is produced, more pipeline capacity is added. Then there's another route, which is coming from Texas. Okay, there it is. Coming across from Texas, Oklahoma area, coming up and through. That's the fracked oil, and the conventional oil is coming out of Texas and Oklahoma. But those lines are pretty much at capacity. And then, if you want to bring in a foreign cargo, there's only one line left that will do that anymore. There used to be many, but the line is called Catline. And it starts in New Orleans, and it comes straight up the Mississippi River Valley. right into Southern Illinois, where things are distributed. Now, Capline actually is running at very low capacity, and it's, in fact, it's been a candidate for reversal. And you say, why? More than a million barrels a day capacity in Capline. That's pretty, most of which is unutilized. The thing is that there is a lot of Canadian oil, so much Canadian oil coming in the Midwest right now. And there's so much Bakken and other frack oil coming in the Midwest right now. There's no need to bring up foreign cargoes arriving by tanker. So anyway, that's the first picture. And that's the first thought I have for you about this elaborate pipeline work. There's a second one. There it is. We are not only have refineries here, but we are a pass-through area. There's a lot of oil that comes into our region and then goes south to the U.S. Gulf Coast. And there are a number of lines that do it. One is called Spearhead, one is called Flanagan and South. They're owned and operated in the region. So we are both a pass-through area and we're a major refining area. So those are the main points that I wanted to make about the pipelines. There's one last. I'll just make this one quick. People want to talk about the pipeline infrastructure being old. You know, there was the Line 5 picture that talked about the ancient pipeline. One of these pipelines built, because we've got an elaborate network here. Well, there was a building boom that went on in the 1950s and 60s. And that's when Line 5 and many other pipelines were built. It was all in that era. I think Line 5 was 61, something like that. But they date from all around there. And the reason for that was that's the Eisenhower era. In the Eisenhower era, we developed the interstate highway system. We developed the St. Lawrence Seaway, and the locks were renovated. The pipeline industry was expanding. So it was a big period of infrastructure expansion for the United States. And then, more recently, you'll note that in the last 15 years, more or less, there's been another pipeline boom, which is another way of saying that at least a lot of these pipelines in this complicated network we just saw are relatively new. Yes, there are old ones, and yes, there are new ones. Okay, so next thing. So that's my comments about pipelines. Next one will be just rail. There's the picture of rail. I've only got the one picture, so it's trying to make it as easy as possible here. When you're talking about rail, when you're talking about the Great Lakes region, you're talking about one city, and that's Chicago, pure and simple. But Chicago is an amazing city. It's they get 1,300 trains a day going through Chicago. Coming through a city like Cleveland, maybe we have 100. I've never counted them. 100 if we're lucky. But Chicago is amazing. And the reason it is just because North is North America's transportation hub. Pretty much every major railroad in the United States and Canada ends in Chicago. They start and end in Chicago. So they can interchange rail cars. So what that means is if you have a Bakken crew and the Bakken crew wants to go to the East Coast, it's going to be drawn to Chicago up, and it's going to move on to the East Coast. If you have Canadian crew, say Vision, that's going to come out of Alberta, and you want to get to the Gulf Coast by rail, it's going to go to the hub and then go down south. And that's the way it is. So it's a very interesting structural property there. So what I'd like to do is I'd like to show you one route in particular so you're familiar with it. This is the main Bakken route. If you look at the green line up there, the green line is it's the Warren Buffett-owned Burlington Northern Railroad. And that's been the primary carrier of the Bakken crew. And the route is to bring it down through Chicago. And then it goes in many routes. This is just one route I'm telling you about, but it's the dominant route. And then it comes across from the CSX line on the red line, across the system, up, over, and down into New York, New Jersey. And that's actually very famous route. It's known as the water level. Many people have written about it. It's a very historic route. This line up here, see what it says, it starts in Chicago, runs straight through Toledo, runs through Cleveland, runs through Erie, goes up to Buffalo. Buffalo is famous because of the Erie Canal. So then it turns east and follows the Erie Canal. Goes through Syracuse, Utica, forget all the cities. But finally, it reaches Albany. Then at Albany, it can turn south and go to New York. So these routes, these crude oil routes, as you were, because they certainly were crude oil routes, number one, follow the water. See, the nice thing about the water level route here is from the standpoint of the railroad is it's relatively flat. You're not going over mountains. You're following the water the whole way. So you're not going over the Appalachians. You're going, skirting them and going through along the canal. The other one is that these rail routes go through major cities. So you're not, they're not rural type routes. And overall, the general statistic would be that of all the North American crude, U.S. and Canadian crude, maybe 5% of it goes by rail. So rail, you know, is an important form of transportation. That's just the point. It's an important form of transportation, but it's dwarfed by the volumes moved by pipeline. Okay, so now I think I'll skip along to talk about water. So let's talk about that next. So here's the here are all the water projects that we know of that relate to the to our area. The big one that's going on right now, some of these are happening, some may happen, some aren't happening, but have happened. They wanted to put everything on one map so you could see it all in one spot. Okay, so the big one that's happening right now is between Montreal and Quebec City. The blue line is a crude oil line, and it goes only as far as Montreal. When you get to Montreal, there's the large refineries really in Quebec City. So it was owned by Valero. So they actually have two Panamax tankers which load in Montreal and keep moving to the Quebec City plant. And it's been a very effective route. It started a few years ago. Was not opposed. And very successful to all intents and purposes. It extends the length of the pipeline, basically. Another one I'd like to point out is Albany, the city of Albany there. The city of Albany has two crude oil terminals. And what they've done is they receive rail cars. As you can see, there's no pipeline going to Albany. But they receive rail cars along that water level route. And then they go down to East Coast refineries, or they load ships that have gone up to St. John's and New Brunswick. They go down the Hudson River, which actually is a little bit deeper than the St. Lawrence Seaway, and it's also relatively free. So, now, as a point of fact, the Albany business has been very low. There's been very little rail to Albany recently. There was a considerable amount of business a few years ago, but it's died down. And I've got some more comments about that later. Great, thanks. Otherwise, the other main routes have been people load barges and off the pipelines in the St. Louis area, that's called the Wood River there. And they also load barges in the Chicago area. And that's been a way of moving crude oil down to the Gulf Coast. In fact, in the Wood River area, there's a terminal that can take bitumen and unload it and transfer it to barge. And then there have been two proposed projects. One in Superior, Wisconsin, and one at Thunder Bay, which had not happened. I merely put them up because they've been under discussion at different times. So you see, there's not been a lot, overall, there's not been a lot of barge and water movement other than the movement to Quebec City. And you might ask, why is that? One reason that would be that it's not been considered more, is that a lot of waterways are seasonal and locks close in the wintertime. So that reduces its usefulness. Another one is waterways have limited access. They don't get to every customer. And in particular, they have no access to the oil fields. So they have to be loaded from, the ships have to be loaded from rail or from pipeline. And that's going to be a costly process to use two forms of transportation. So that's an overall quick view of how crude moves. That's how it does move into our states and provinces here. Now I've got one last slide and a few minutes to talk about it. Perfect amount of time. And I wanted to talk about a few projects and their impact, because what's kind of interesting is that this is not a static system at all. It's very dynamic. It's been changing over the last 80 years. It's been changing since World War II. Lots of pipelines have been built, lots of things move different ways, new markets open up. So here's what's going on now. I'm going to just talk about three because of limited time. There are more. First one, let's talk about Dakota Access Pipeline. As you all know, or probably, I'm sure you all know, Dakota Access Pipeline started up and is capable of moving over 500,000 barrels a day. And it's been under a lot of dispute for a very long period of time. But here's a picture of the Dakota Access. It's actually paired with another pipeline. This is not often talked about, and there's this one. It's a converted gas line. So the idea is that the Dakota Access Pipeline is going to take virtually half the Bakken oil production, and it's going to move it to the Gulf Coast. Well, what that would do, one would expect, is it would reduce the amount of the Bakken moving by rail to the East Coast, because you're opening up an entirely new market for it. And pipeline is a very cost-effective form of transportation. So that's one thing that's going on that's going to impact us, most likely. Another one, this is the one up on top, the Energy East pipeline. Energy East, actually, looking at the picture there, it runs right through our region. It doesn't come into the United States, but sure goes through Ontario, Quebec quite nicely. And what it will be is it will be an export terminal for Canada. So if this is built, and it's still under discussion, if it is built, it will be able to move maybe 1 million barrels a day of Canadian production, much of which to export. Yes, there's a refinery in Montreal, yes, there's one in Quebec City that's Levis, and yes, there's one in St. John, which is huge. But still, it opens up a big export market. And then the last one is Trans Mountain, which is another one. It would go from, the Trans Mountain is going to go from Edmonton down to Vancouver and open up an export market there. Essentially, what that's going to do is that will take a huge quantity of Canadian oil and shift it west so it goes to export markets there. And that will pull barrels away from our region. So that's it. I think I've pulled it in on time. So. Thank you very much.